Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Eggs and Issues. I'm Dave Creutzfeldt. I'm the mayor here of Oskaloosa, and I'll be doing the moderating of the event this morning. So first, as we get started, as is typical, I want to acknowledge the folks that are here first and some of the contributions that are being made to make this all possible. First, I want to say thank you to Smokey Row for allowing this to take place in their fine establishment. Midwest One for providing the delicious coffee. Hopefully you've all had a chance to sample that. And I want to especially thank Steve Hicks, who is pouring it flawlessly over there. We have a lot of media here this morning as well, and so we want to say a special thank you to Oski News, the Oskaloosa Herald for their reporting, The Sun, CRI, and also KBOE Radio, who are all going to be reporting on this event. This session is focusing on local activities, so we're highlighting three initiatives that are going on. First, the Recreation and Early Childhood Development Center, that we've got starring Mark Willett back here. Get out of the way. The Community Branding Project, we've got Aaron Riggs and Andrew Jensen, and then also the Caldwell Learning Center, starring Linda Fox and Dave Sedovec. Our state legislators usually don't get applause. I don't know what the deal is there. So we're going to be doing things a little bit differently today. I have asked the representatives to do a short presentation to bring us up to speed on their project and the progress that they're having before we go into the question and answers. What I've asked is that we would ask 10 minutes each of them to just bring us up to speed, so that's about a half hour's worth of information, and then we would go into our question and answers. My intention is to go a solid hour with the questions and answers, so plan on finishing up around 10 o'clock instead of the normal 9:30. On that said, if you have additional questions, the broadcast stops at 10 o'clock, but if you have other thoughts or questions you want to talk to them about, you can just come on up here after it's over with, and then I'm sure they'd be happy to answer any questions one-on-one. And so with that said, let's go ahead and get started. Aaron and Andrew, would you start us off with the community branding?
Sure. Thank you so much for coming out. There are so many people here today. It's great to see everybody out, and we'd like to reiterate all the thanks that that Dave said for the local media and Smokey Row and everybody for coming. I am here, of course, with Aaron Riggs. We're going to be talking about the community branding initiative. For just a little bit of an introduction, as I am Andrew Jensen, I've been here in Oskaloosa for a little over 2 years. I'm on the brand leadership team that's working on the branding effort. I'm the director of Mahaska Community Development Group. It's the Economic Development Corporation here in Oskaloosa in Mahaska County. My wife and I, although we didn't grow up here, we grew up in a small town in Iowa, not that much different from Oskaloosa. We've been out of state for a while and looking to move back with our four young kids to a small town where we can raise them with small town Iowa values and be able to really get in deep with the community and help promote all that is good. So with that, I'm going to turn it over for Aaron. He's going to provide a little bit of perspective and background on the project.
Thank you, Andrew. I too want to thank everyone for coming out tonight, or today rather, this morning. It's encouraging to see so many people here to have an interest in the issues and the topics being presented. And I, too, look forward to hearing your questions and your comments regarding the branding initiative. I've prepared some notes, so I'm a little more succinct today. To get started, a little bit about me. I'm Aaron Riggs. I'm the youth representative on the brand leadership team, youngest person on the brand team. I was born and raised in Oskaloosa, so I'm a local boy, if you will. And my wife and I recently bought a house here, too. I work at Vermeer and Pella in their video department. And so I'm a part of this effort because I, like many of you, want to see our town grow and thrive. To start off with, I want to talk a little bit about sort of what the primary goals were of the branding initiative and the branding effort. For one, it was to establish a unified marketing message. There's many entities in town. It's important that each one are presenting the same message as they market themselves and each other and the community. So a similar look and feel is desirable. As well, increase retail spending in the downtown, make Oskaloosa a destination, and increase foot traffic in the downtown. One of the things that our branding effort hopes to achieve is to bring people downtown, and in doing that, we'll increase foot traffic in the downtown, as well as give reason for businesses to set up downtown due to that increased foot traffic, and thus increase the retail spending in the downtown. So some primary reasons for undertaking the branding effort were to put Oskaloosa on the map as a desirable place to live, visit, and raise a family, as well as distinguish Oskaloosa among the other communities in Iowa and throughout the Midwest, to encourage families to live and work in Oskaloosa, and to stop and slow the leakage of locally earned money being spent elsewhere. So rather than people living here, earning a wage here, and then taking that money and spending it in a community outside of Oskaloosa, wouldn't it be great if there were enough reasons and things to do in and around our town that people could spend that money here locally and keep that here and grow our local economy as a result? So throughout this whole process, a branding team was put together, and that branding team was made up of about 18 individuals, and many of them are here today, and at this time I'd just like to ask that they could stand up and so that everyone in the room can know who these branding members are. Go ahead and stand up, branding team. These are business people, property owners, volunteers, many of whom are champions of the branding and are helping to make it happen. Thanks, you can sit down. So after the presentation, I encourage you to ask them any questions as well as give them your comments. We're certainly here to continue to spread the have the conversation and spread information. And so this team was tasked with developing and advising on the brand, which was about a 3-month process. And through that process, one of the things that we did in developing this brand was taking a look at was to receive community input. And one of the ways we did that was through a survey where 1,500 people had responded and answered questions about what some of the strengths and weaknesses were of Oskaloosa and what some of the things were that they knew to be staples of Oskaloosa, things that we could capitalize on and really push in marketing messages and make ourselves be known for. And throughout all that then, a logo and brand was developed, and that is the Oskaloosa Simply Brilliant logo and slogan that you're very familiar with. A little bit about what Simply Brilliant is though. Just want to talk about that. Simply Brilliant means creating a single set of imagery and language to highlight and promote the very best of Oskaloosa. Goes back to that unified marketing message goal, as well as bringing attention to a strong legacy of music in the community and centrality of the town square as a place for social engagement. Simply Brilliant is about promoting and the many beautifully lit evening activities and events within the town, whether that be Thursday night band concerts, activities and events, ball games at the Lacey Recreation Complex, as well as performances at the George Daly Auditorium. But it's important to realize that Simply Brilliant isn't, and that logo and that brand slogan isn't necessarily what's going to make people want to come to Oskaloosa. Because what's really going to encourage people to come are products. And that's really what a logo, or that's really what a brand is more about, is the products, not just a logo and a slogan. Take Ford and Chevy, for example. You don't want to buy a vehicle from one company or the other just because you like their logo or slogan, their colors, or the design of the font that they use for their brand. Rather, you buy one car over the other because you like the way one car handles more than another. You like the way the entertainment system in the Chevy, or you like the number of cup holders in the Ford, maybe. And so that's a product, and that's why people buy into a brand, is because they like the product. And so that begs the question, so what are Oskaloosa's products? What are the things that we as a community want to enjoy? And what are the things that visitors will want to come visit us for? What are our products? What do we have to offer? And the answer to those questions will ultimately make our brand way more so than any logo or slogan. And I think that's an important point. And we already have some great products. Like I mentioned, the Lacey Complex, the Recreation Trail, George Daley Auditorium, and then of course our downtown square. But just having those spaces isn't enough. It's about what people do and experience in those spaces that will help solidify our brand, make a name for ourselves. Right now, that Simply Brilliant is a goal. It's a mission statement. But over time, we need to earn that, and I think we can do that. So we've had a lot of support, and it's been encouraging to see the community rally behind the brand. I know of a lot of things that have happened as a result of this initiative and this effort. Letters to the editor, artistic talent, such as the bike rack by Great Expectations. And so as a young person, it's really exciting to think about how great of a community this is to live in, where people are eager to help make the community better. And this branding effort is just as much about preserving and celebrating our community's heritage as it is enhancing and improving our spaces so that they remain relevant and continue to be utilized. Ultimately, so that we living here and those who visit the community can see just how great or brilliant our town is. And we're already off to a good start with some of those changes and initiatives. And I'm gonna let Andrew talk about what those are that have happened as a result of the branding effort.
Thanks, Aaron. I'm gonna refer to these handouts that are on the table. There are probably more someplace around. Karen Hafner probably has a few more, perhaps. Put her on the spot. I'm not gonna go over all of these in detail, just spend 1 minute or so to do it. We've been communicating first on the top with businesses, organizations around the community. If your business or your organization would like to hear from us, we'd love to get your feedback, discuss these issues in a lot more detail, and we've done that across the community based on the keeping going down curb appeal. The community marketing expert had a lot of recommendations. We can see things happening around town. It's really exciting for those things. There's a new tourism committee that's come right out of this. The chamber has taken ownership kind of that. And you'll see on the napkin holders, you can go online and vote for the very best of Oskaloosa. This is gonna go feed directly into a brochure that will be used for some of the marketing efforts for tourism that we're hoping to do. You can see Aaron and I and several other people in the crowd are already sporting some merchandise that's available at the Chamber building as well as Mahaska Drug. New events, this is gonna be exciting. I mean, really at one of the core things of this is creating the downtown, the town square, as a place where people want to go, where people want to hang out, and to have just regular amounts of activity and programmed entertainment in the downtown area is really core to what we wanna be able to do. A place where people just wanna go and hang out to see and be seen, if you will. And so anyway, the Oskaloosa Main Street has hired an events planner and coordinator that's gonna be helping to bring more things to the downtown area, and we're excited about that. Moving on the right side, we've already purchased banners that are going up around town. There's a facade improvement program that's gonna have a big impact, hundreds of thousands of dollars to improving downtown buildings. It's exciting. Wayfinding, I'm gonna comment just real quick that from an outside perspective, it is actually fairly difficult to get around Oskaloosa. And so having a consistent set of wayfinding and directions around town is really important to the community. So a plan has recently been approved for that. Talking about Wi-Fi in the square, an exciting thing that a group that's kind of spun off and doing their own thing, but very excited about it is the working on the alley just on the other side of Smoky Row is a place where you can be outside seating, lighting, just to enjoy being downtown. There's a lot more on here. I'd be happy to take your questions, but I know that I'm out of time now, so.
Okay, next up, we have Mark Willett, having to do with the Recreation and Early Childhood Development Project.
Thanks, Dave. Just to go through what Andrew and Aaron said, appreciate everybody coming in. I realize everybody's here to probably talk about these other issues. Don't really necessarily have any interest in the early child care and recreation, but so I'll try to keep this brief. But I'm Mark Willett, and I'm Vice President and General Manager of Cloud Valve. I moved to Oskaloosa in 2000. In this town, I met my wife, and we had our first child here, and then moved around with our parent company, and then came back in 14. he's shy. So this community is really where my life started, certainly where my career started, and where I intend to finish it. And with that comes a lot of pride, and what I look forward to is trying to move this entire community and county forward, and is largely why I'm standing up here this morning. So just to start from scratch on this, the fall of 2014, I'm also on the board of the Mahaska County Development Group. The YMCA came to us as business leaders in the city and county, and talked to us about the state of the current YMCA, which is recreation and childcare. And it's not just the YMCA facility, that childcare takes place as well at Webster and at Kids Corner and University Park. And at that point, they were at a crossroads in which financially they're having troubles getting by. And was talking to us about ideas to improve the situation. So at that point, I probably should have left, but I talked too much, and again, why I'm standing up here. But it was a great opportunity for us as employers and citizens of Mahaska County. Initially and still today, we realize that to lose the YMCA in this community would be devastating to us as employers as well as citizens. Currently, we serve approximately 320 children in childcare. To just have that close is going to be a strain on all of our other providers and will most likely lead to children not being able to be cared for properly, things of that nature. So it's important that we try to keep this open, but it's also important that we do it wisely and think through everything. So, from that point on, we got to work, and we created a subcommittee within MCDG to start working on gathering facts as to why things were the way they were. The initial step was a survey that we sent out. It was horribly painful to take. It was 35 minutes, you'll never get back. But for those of you that took time to actually complete that survey, we thank you very much, because honestly, those over 700 responses we got are what created the vision that we have today that we're talking about. And from that survey, I know you can't all see it, but I'd encourage you to come up and take a look at it after we're done. And I'd be happy to answer any questions. But virtually every aspect of this drawing is a result of that survey. Because we felt that the only reason why we could possibly be unsuccessful in the current recreation and childcare is because we weren't meeting the needs of our citizens throughout Mahaska County. And so to do that, we designed it around what they actually wanted. That survey was a great tool. We had a large number of people that responded to that weren't existing members of the Y, or recreation and childcare. Of those responses, a great number of them, 80-some percent, said that they would consider joining if it actually was constructed and met their needs from a recreation standpoint. From a childcare standpoint, a lot of people said they loved the programs. Everybody said they loved the programs in our childcare facilities, and that was a great news for us. However, what they didn't like was the facilities themselves. They were ran down. They didn't have drinking fountains. They didn't have all these things that the kids needed in Webster and Kids Corner and things of that nature. So, but they were kind of an even split on how they wanted to handle that. We could either renovate a Webster, for instance, or we could look at new construction. But the thing is they want it co-located with the recreation center, and they really would like it close to elementary school. For those families that have children that may be going to childcare, but they have older kids that are going to the elementary. Saves time, things of that nature. And also for the wraparound care. Children who have working parents that drop their kids off for childcare before and after school. We don't have logistical issues with buses traveling across town, things of that nature. As well as our early childcare. Being able to provide swim lessons to our really, really young kids that are still in car seats, for instance, that they can't be transported via bus. So this would allow them to get swim lessons and things, which is all part of the program, right there together. So another thing is, and that's to wrap that up, that's this part right here is the early child care center attached directly to it. The other one was a secure entrance. They did not like the fact that we didn't have tight, secure entrances, so that's part of this as well. You'll have to have check-in badges or whatever, or be checked in from either way, however you come in here. Another thing I did not realize, because it's surprising as it might be, I'm not a big swimmer, but we have a huge swim program in town, both the high school and then the YMCA has a program as well that gets them ready and goes into high school. And I was blown away by the number of kids that we have in that. I think nearly 100, something like that, kids. So that was a big deal. And so as you can see, we have a large pool here. That's a big dollar figure right there. So, I mean, I know we're talking about big money here, so I just want to point these things out. But it's extremely important. Nearly 75% of the memberships, current memberships at the YMCA, are tied to the aquatics. So if we're going to do this, we need the aquatics. Otherwise, it's going to be a waste of time, and it certainly will not be sustainable. So, and then on top of it, when it's eight lanes, because the existing facility is only four. And again, I've never been to a swim meet, but I have some friends and acquaintances that have children in it, and it's a nightmare to have a swim meet, so I've been told, at the Y, because of the four lanes. It takes forever, it's extremely crowded. And the surrounding facilities have eight-lane pools or six-lane pools and areas to actually sit down and watch your kids compete and things of that nature. So that's the reason for the size of the pool. The next part is the rec pool. Why in the world do you want a rec pool as well? Excellent question. What we found from our other users and people that were interested in using the Y is they couldn't use it because it was only four lanes and everybody was always in it. Nobody wants to swim at 9 o'clock in the morning because a lot of us have jobs. So that throws that out. So now you're limited to 5 o'clock in the morning, which is always fun. Yeah. Noon, which is always packed. So you've got four lanes and it's hard to swim on top of each other in a four lane pool. And then in the evenings, which I'm never home because of certain activities from kids. So that makes it difficult as well. And then on top of it, you have water aerobics and things of that nature. And I also learned that competition swimming, they like the water to be cold. And people doing water aerobics don't necessarily enjoy cold water. So I didn't know that either, but it makes sense. So that's what drove us to the two different pools, is to allow that to serve two different needs, but also be large enough to facilitate that need and allow people to come in and utilize the resource all at the same time. So that was a big ticket item as well. Again, you can't see it, but the size is bigger. I've heard a lot of people say that, why does it have to be so big? It's big because the current existing facility is cramped. Before we did the improvements, through Dave Phelps led, who is the new director of the Y. When you're running on the treadmill, there was a good chance you're probably going to rub sweaty elbows with the person next to you, which is generally gross. So this allows us to spread those things out a little bit and so that you're more comfortable. There's more treadmills, there's more ellipticals, there's more area to move around so that you're comfortable as well. So there's current sizes on here versus what the proposed sizes are as well. So that's a key component to that. There's a youth gym that's going to be tied to the early education part of this that'll allow large motor skills for our young kids who are over here in the education side, and also a large track, indoor track around the gym, which is in addition to what we have today as well. So again, all of this is driven by that survey, and then we had focus groups after that in which we invited people to come in. How many we have of those? Four or five?
Ten.
Or ten. focus groups where we invited people to come in. Had a pretty good turnout for that, and we also listened to those individuals and customized that as well. This is not a project that we just thought of last month and threw numbers together and threw a drawing together and then came to the public and said, let's all throw in our 1% sales tax and spend $24 million to build this because it feels good and it's cool. The goal of this is to provide, similar to the branding, provide a resource in town that allows us to continue to draw young families, such as mine, businesses, new businesses that want to come here, that want to come here because we have things to do in town. They don't come here to live just to turn around and drive to Des Moines or drive to Pella or drive to Ottumwa or all those things. It is, a lot of people said, build it and it will come. You know, that you can look at it that way, but you can also find cities everywhere that have done this successfully. It's not just a wing and a prayer. It's something that's systematic, strategic, and that communities come together all over the country to do things like this to better themselves and the county. And I think we'll probably cover about everything else in the questions. Not that there will be any questions, but I will say this, and this is how I'll close it, is there are a lot of people in this room today, and yeah, there are a lot of them here for this specific topic, so I'm the lucky one, but there are people in here that are going to vote yes for this right here today. There are people that, regardless of what I say today, are going to vote no, and that's fine. But the interesting, what I'm really passionate about are those people that are here that don't know, that aren't saying things that aren't true, that are wanting to educate themselves prior to going and voting. Those are the individuals I respect and I really want to talk to because I want informed voters. And as a community, if we come together as a group of informed voters and decide that this isn't, as a group, as an entire Mahaska County facility or community, what we need to do to get better, then that's all I ask. That's all I ask, that's all anybody asks, is to please listen. We have done a lot of work on this. There are a lot of facts. There are no secrets. I'll tell you anything you want to know that I can possibly think of knowing anyway. But most importantly, there are things that I don't know the answers to, and those are the ones I have to understand, that we have to understand as a group, so that we can go back and address those to make everybody feel comfortable about this. So again, thank you. Am I out of time, Dave?
Yes.
Good. Excellent. I'm out of time.
Thank you, Mark. Now, Linda Fox, Dave Sedevec, can you talk to us about the Caldwell Learning Center?
Let the short people come up front. Good morning. We are here today to hear about mainly what's going to be on that referendum when we go to vote. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself to start out with, because most of you know I was a children's librarian for 30 years. And then something magical happened. I retired. And anybody that's retired can grin along with me, because this is a wonderful life. And when I retired, you have people with their hands out saying, won't you come volunteer? Well, I was told that be pretty picky about what you volunteer for. And my husband had served on conservation board several years ago, and I said, you know, if I was on a board, I think that's the one I'd really like to be on. Well, lo and behold, they needed a woman for gender balance on that board. And I filled the bill. But let me tell you, has anybody ever heard of free-range chickens? Yeah. You know, they're healthy, they walk around. I was a free-range kid. I got to experience nature in its finest. I got to see it, I got to hear it, and I got to touch it. And as all the teachers in this group know, that's how kids learn, is being able to experience and feel and touch what is around them. Now, we've been hearing about Oskaloosa all this time, but what we really need to keep in mind is we are a county. We are Mahaska County, and when I worked at the library, I found that we are the center of a huge area around us. People come from all over the area to get into our community. The only way we can make it grow is to work together. Now, I've pulled a lot of books for teachers on different subject areas, and one of the subject areas in science they learn about is ecosystems. Y'all know what ecosystems are? You know, where we have a balance. In order to make everything work, everything has to work together. And I think that is one of the most important things we can do within this community is county work with city, and city work with county, and we'll all be happy. Now, I came into this project of the new Environmental Learning Center. It started in 2008, and I wasn't a part of the planning committee. So I had a lot of learning to do. And if anybody comes on a new board, they learn there's a lot of acronyms that you have to get used to in this day and age on what is what. Well, ELC, who can tell me what that is? Environmental Learning Center. What is an Environmental Learning Center anyway? I mean, is it? It's a place where you can take nature and you can make it work. You can show kids how to do things and what things are in nature. They can have hands-on experience. They can go out in the field and come back into a mudroom and experience what is going on. Well, when they started this building plan in 2008, Farmer Bob hadn't discovered the mammoth bones. And those mammoth bones have made a big difference in what we're trying to do for this learning center. The county purchased them. They're ours. They're all of ours. And it is an exciting thing that has happened within our county. Do you realize how many other counties around would love to have this in their area? Do you realize how rare it is? We have dug up three parts of mammoth bones. Now, there is a secret. Nobody knows exactly why or how those mammoth bones all got in one area, or how many more we'll discover, but we're limited in time. But because we have them, we have to have a place to display them. This makes us in a really unique position in the fact that people will come. You build it and they will come. They'll want to see what it is. And once they see not only the mammoth bones and the history of our wonderful state over the eons of time, we have something very special here to offer. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dave to give you the facts and figures of what's going on.
Thanks, Linda. Well, great, I get to follow that. I'm the boring numbers guy. Anyhow, as most of you know, the Conservation Education Center out at Russell Wildlife was built in 1986. And the main reason for this building that we're trying to plan now, this Environmental Learning Center, is that we're a victim of our own success. We average over 12,000 program participants a year here in Mahaska County with one naturalist and then other staff helping out. To put that in perspective, that's the same number of program participants that Linn County has with five naturalists in the Cedar Rapids area. We have the first county to have the Brass Bluegill Award, which is the Iowa DNR for aquatic education. We're the first county to ever have two different naturalists earn that award, Pete Uralde and then Laura DeCook. 3 years ago, the Oskaloosa Elementary School won the Iowa Conservation Education Council Award for the Outstanding School District Working with the County Program in the state. And the next year, Laura DeCook won the award for the Outstanding Naturalist for a county with two or less naturalists. So we've been unbelievably blessed in this county for years with a great education program. The planning for Caldwell started in 2008, and that was 2 years before I got here. I wasn't involved in the initial planning. One thing that has amazed me, I've lived on gravel most of my adult life, and the Conservation Education Center out at Russell is on gravel, and it has shocked me the number of people that will not drive a mile on gravel to go there. And like Linda said, we have the mammoth bones, but what we have to stress is this building was planned way before the mammoth bones were ever discovered. And with the mammoth bones, we were lucky to acquire them through a grant, so tax dollars weren't used to acquire the mammoth bones. Since about 2014, we've been working with supervisors on funding for this. We had tried to do it through private fundraising. We have raised some money, but as a lot of you guys know out there, that it's a public building, it's a government-owned building. It's been tough to get private people to donate money to build a government building. They're more than willing to help with the displays and the things like that, but the actual bricks and mortar, you know, it's been a tough sell. The supervisors have been great trying to help us come up with ways to fund this building, and I think it's gonna be, you know, great for everybody all around. If you wanna come up later, we have copies of the new redesign of the building. This is actually design F, which means it's the fifth change that's taken place since this project started. When we started working with the county supervisors, they said, you know, okay, in 2008, you proposed a $3 million building. In 2014, 2015 dollars, that was up to a $3.8 million building. So we had to make some cuts, do some changes, and we have it back down to the $3 million price tag. And they've been great working with us, and that's what we're trying to accomplish. One thing Linda can talk with you later is one of the things, the mammoth display is gonna go where we had originally a library room set. Well, going to different nature centers around the whole state, most nature centers felt the library was the most underutilized part of the building. So we were able to transform that area to a mammoth display and not need extra square footage and extra dollars. So that's one thing we did. But something I want to point out is we've worked with a lot of partners. There's Friends of Mahaska County Conservation that have helped try to raise money. Mahaska County Rec Foundation, we have the bike trail going right through our property. Basically, the building can be like a trailhead. The American Legion Auxiliary has worked. We have the Freedom Rock out there. And so I'm excited about all of the partners that have taken place here. Like I said, we're going to open up for questions. And if people want to come up, like there's breaks or afterwards, we can show you the pictures of the floor plans and all that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the information. There's a lot there. Now, there might be some piece of information they missed. Is there anybody who would like to ask a question of any of the three entities that are up here to get us started this morning?
I just kind of like to make a statement. One goal of the rebranding is to eliminate the use of iconic bandstand logo. Oskaloosa has a brand that we have used for marketing for decades. Our current brand is the result of years of work, time, and expense, and has served as well. Ineffective marketing of our musical, architectural, and historical heritage, our brand is no reason to discard it in search of a magic bullet. Branding is used to promote a product, in this case, a commodity. Rebranding is used to overcome a tarnished reputation or to reinvent oneself, which does not apply to us. We have a brand that has stood the test of time, that of music. We have a logo, the iconic bandstand. We have a slogan, note the difference. There is no reason to change to a theme of lights or a slogan of simply brilliant. Roger Brooks sold that as a way to justify converting the square into a limelight plaza. What Brooks failed to mention is that the words he suggested, simply brilliant, were not his to sell, promote, or give away. Those words carry a word mark which is commonly thought of as a trademark, according to the USPTO, and our patent attorney, neither Brooks or the BLT, the City of Oskaloosa, nor anyone else has the right to use the word Simply Brilliant as a brand or a slogan. We currently possess a brand. The square has the Montgomery Restrictive Covenant and is on our National Register of Historic Places. The use of the word Simply Brilliant can and will be challenged in court. Therefore, we ask that the city manager, and the council members sign a pledge or enact an ordinance that will prohibit any material alterations to the bandstand and the square, now and in the future. We ask them to pledge to stop the rebranding effort and to cease the use of the new Burst logo and the slogan, Simply Brilliant. We ask that they promise to stop using it on their marketing materials, the city vehicles, and in any and all of their marketing efforts. The park and square should never be materially altered, and we have a brand that is representative of our past, present, and future. That's what we should be using to sell our community. Thank you.
Hey, we don't really have many city council members here, so part of that we'd have to disregard. Andrew, do you have any kind of a response to that?
Am I on? Hey, thank you for bringing all those things up. First, I think first I'm going to address just the legal issues with the trademarking. The brand leadership team has absolutely been working with attorneys. We know that we are on solid ground. Aaron and I are absolutely not attorneys. We're not patent attorneys, but the group has been working with it, and we know that where we are on that issue. Let me tell you, to trademark anything, it's a long and very involved process. Actually, just last week, there was another document that reached a milestone in that effort. So we're going to continue using it, and we do know that we're on solid ground from the advice that we've received on using the Simply Brilliant and the logo design. I would take a little bit of an issue with suggesting that it is just Roger Brooks who is selling this particular idea. I'd go back to what Aaron was saying. The 1,500 responses, the meetings that we had around the community, and a group of close to 20 people that were selected as a cross section of the entire community. So it was young people, old people, business owners, professionals, people who've been in the community for a long time, people like myself who are relatively new, and it was through that collective effort that was put together, and then. Really with the brand, I mean, it's all about bringing people and activity downtown to our square. We need to be able to have a package, an identity to be able to sell and market what we're doing. And it is, we absolutely celebrate our musical history, but Oskaloosa is much more than just music. In the time that I've been here, there are so many awesome things going on in Oskaloosa, and the question is, how do we tie those things together, promote them, get people downtown, get businesses to be able to expand retail opportunities in the area. So that's some of my response. I'd certainly be willing to take more direct questions. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, just a reminder to folks that if you are making comments, you direct them to the folks that are up on the stage. So if you have a call for action for the city council or the county supervisors, this really isn't the right place to do it.
Just to reiterate and go off of what Andrew had said, you know, I think one of the things that we should all also recognize is how much the community has rallied behind this effort and gotten involved. People that haven't been involved before, I think, have started to become involved because of the excitement knowing that this effort, knowing what this effort can do to our community and really make it a great place, bring some new things about it. And also, this is not about destroying heritage or tarnishing symbols, things that we are well known for and will continue to be well known for. In fact, I don't want to see the bandstand go away. It should not move, and what it represents to our community should not go away either. But I think there is something to be said about rebranding and trying a different image and starting a new path that very well could help our community in terms of how others see us, as well as excite us and give us something to be excited about as well.
May I hold it, please? My name is Carol Kelderman, and I need to refute some of the things that they're saying. First of all, we began our effort more than a year ago. I don't know if you know Barbara Sundstrom, whose father owns Sundstrom's clothing store, and Debbie Brady, whose dad had Brady's shoes, but between us and among us, we have more than 4,000 people who have sent us comments. When this group talks about public input, that's not entirely accurate. They had an online survey, and there were responses there which we never saw. However, we went into the chamber and tallied every remark that they had in their notebook. There are 9,000 remarks in that notebook, and there is not one that refers to let's get a new brand other than the brand that we have. What they're also not telling you is the marketing plan indicates that one of the things they would like to do is make your square into a limelight plaza to follow the lighting theme. That is a $6 million project, and it involves, as this young lady said, a light show every night of the week. They expect your retailers to rally around that, keep their stores open, and stand the cost of that. Nobody's opposed to revitalization, and nobody's opposed to marketing the town. But if you market this town, it needs to be marketed on who we are and who we've been. We are not lights. This town is not lights. This town is music, architectural heritage, Weatherall buildings, and a number of things like that. The other thing that they're not telling you is indeed our attorney in Washington, D.C. provided this. The words Simply Brilliant are indeed trademarked. Roger Brooks International is not listed anywhere in the United States Trademark Patenting Office anywhere. This trademark is owned by a company who sent us an email, who is concerned about the infringement, and they will indeed take action. That aside, I do not want to be known as a town that is simply brilliant. And out of the 3,000 and 4,000 comments we've had on our pages and to us personally, very few people want to be known as simply brilliant. We're the city of music that we've been known for internationally for years. We've been in international publications. Our bandstand is world renowned, and it's insane to think that that should be a plaza, a $6 million plaza, with a light show every night of the week. They're going to tell you that that's not the truth, but it is, and we've been researching this for almost 2 years. So I'd appreciate it if you get, don't, oh, and the city, the Simply Brilliant slogan, the other thing,
you gotta
I'm
wind
sorry,
it up.
That's fine. The Simply Brilliant slogan would be painted on all of your vehicles. They will remove the iconic bandstand logo. This is in the plan. It says to obliterate the use of the current icon. It says obliterate. Thanks.
Okay.
So when Roger Brooks, the consultant, came and spoke to us, he gave us a list of recommendations. And we as the brand leadership team are looking over those recommendations and referring to those just as recommendations, not things that we have to do, things that we have to follow to the T, but rather recommendations. And as the brand leadership team, our goal, our job is to now take those recommendations and adapt them to what we understand our community to be and want it to be. And so when it refers to turning the downtown square into Limelight Plaza, you know, That's an idea from one person. It's not necessarily what we're going to do, and in fact, we haven't really talked about at all what is going to happen to the downtown square, mainly because it's something that will not even come about or could even be constructed or funded or whatever for at least another year and a half, maybe two or a couple more years after that. You know, there's many issues on the table right now with in regards to where money can come from for to address those issues. So that's something that will come about later on. And we'll definitely adapt and take those recommendations and formulate those in a manner that is fitting and is appropriate for the community. Also in regards to the logo and its copyright status, trademark status, you know, I think what legal counsel has told us, but again, we're not lawyers, is that you can certainly have a slogan refer to one topic in one category in one area and have another slogan refer to another topic and category in another area, and those two paths, as long as they aren't referring to the same product, is okay. But obviously I'm not a lawyer, so I would ask that you refer to that.
Okay. Other comments or questions?
Granted, I may have lived under a rock for the 27 years I've lived here, but I did not know this was known as the City of Music. Just saying.
Next question. I'm hoping for a question.
Yeah, you said that 80% of the people that were surveyed recommend that they would go to the YMCA. Just as a show of hands, how many people in the last 60 days have used the YMCA or have a membership there? Okay, thank you.
Is the new rec center definitely going to be YMCA, or will it be a rec center?
It will be owned by the city. The facility will be owned by the city. And we have, I don't know all the answers on how that works when it's owned by the city. They'll have to be, the operator will have to be fully vetted and selected by the city ultimately. But I think it's probably true that it will not be operated by the city, and there's various reasons for that. For one, I'm not the city, but the city doesn't have the staff and the expertise available to them to be able to operate a facility like that and bring the programs that our children and adults that are working out in the recreation side need, and to hire that expertise would be quite expensive. So as of right now, the operation of the facility and who operates it isn't absolutely said and done because of how that works politically once the city actually has ownership of the building.
Since you're saying that you don't know who's going to operate it, my point would be that the YMCA certainly isn't a candidate for it because they just had a building built in my lifetime and tore down the one on High Avenue, the old Y that was a historic site, and tore it down, and the new building built there. But they have not used their funds adequately or promoted properly or whatever, because, you know, if the city builds a recreational facility and then has to continue to pay for it while somebody else is making money off of it, it's not the proper way to go on it. So I don't know what you would do there, but you know, once you build the building, I think the city's involvement should be done with it. They should lease it to somebody or something to be able to at least cover the expenses and stuff that are going to be generated from the thing.
I agree 100% with that. As to the success of the Y as an organization operating it, I'll handle that in two separate answers. Whether it's a Y or whether it's not, with the ownership going to the city, there will be a board that's developed as an oversight board for the facility. There will be a lease to whoever operates it. And the structure of that lease obviously will be determined. But that lease, obviously, if they start losing money, then, I mean, just like anybody, they're going to have to go, I would guess. But that oversight board will be the financial responsibility oversight board of the facility to make sure that it's paying its way, that it's keeping the capital improvements up so that the facility doesn't get ran down. And with everything, I agree. I haven't been around that long, but I haven't seen the previous Y before this one. But this one was built in 69. And community needs grow. And what people want to do at a recreation and child care center change and grow with the times. And while to close the existing facility, it will be reused, but more importantly, the facility that we're going to build, we're trying to design in size for the next 100 years. But I mean, don't fool yourself. Unless we continue to look at that we've talked a lot otherwise, and unless we continue to look at that at every 5 to 10 years and make sure we're financially stable and provide money to internally through operations and memberships to change it and keep it fresh every 5 to 10 years, it could be a problem just like it is today. So I won't hide behind that at all.
Hi, I'm Roger Beam. I came from a community half the size of Oskaloosa. It was Olwine, Iowa, northeast Iowa. And a few years ago, they built an early childhood center, a state-of-the-art auditorium, and a rec center. And the use of all those, they were in conjunction, they cooperated with the school, so it was attached to the school, so the school could use it. And the amount of people that have increased has been built there. They have now have a situation where you can just put in a keypad card and you can go in there and work out at 4 o'clock in the morning or at 11 o'clock at night. So they have a lot of access to the community. Another thing about the center is the fact that, you know, they say, well, you build something like that for the young people, but it's not only the young people, it's a lot of old people, middle-aged people. It's something that, you know, they have a gym there, they have a place to lift weights, they have a place for teaching classes. Another thing that has happened in just the last few years is they just landed a Penn battery company that's going to hire 350 people, and the wage is from $15 to $17. So just that one thing was going to make a big difference in the community. But it's, you know, whether the rec center had anything to do with it, but I'm sure that's one of the things that the community showed all the people that were there to view the community. This is some of the things that we have to offer your people that are going to be working here in this community. So I think if you're going to be a progressive, looking towards your future, all these things we have up here are, a good thing for the people of Oskaloosa, but also, like you said, around the community of Oskaloosa. And I think this is looking forward, not just staying stagnant. And I think that's really important. Thank you.
I've lived in Oskaloosa most of my life. And when I was in grade school, this town had about 10,000 people in it. I'm now almost 65. The town still has 10,000 people in it. Don't tell me that there's progression going on. Nothing is going to change what it is today. There used to be a lot of merchants around the town. That's changed. We've got Walmart. We've got the internet. People buy off the internet. They go to Walmart. The uptown's not going to go change. Look around the square. Lawyers, handicap store, a restaurant or two. The best place in town is True Value Hardware. And that is not going to change. No matter how much money or time and effort you're going to do, retail is dead. The only thing that's going to bring this town back to life is manufacturing to get some decent paying jobs here. If you don't get the jobs, you have nothing. And the place will be 10,000 people 20 years from now. Okay? Now, I would like to say that I appreciate all the work these people do on this stuff, but you got to get back to the grassroots. Without money, you don't have anything. You've tapped out everybody here that's a property owner. My house sits on a 50 by 100-foot lot. $2,212 a year taxes on that little sucker. What are you going to do, come for me for more money? I can't afford it. I'm going to be on the welfare rolls. And I'm tired of working for nothing but the government. I'm done.
Care to respond?
I don't know if that was necessarily directed at any one of us, but as the Director of Economic Development, I'd like to actually address a few things. First of all, I am for low taxes. I hate paying my taxes to the government. I mean, I think that's pretty darn American. So I certainly agree with that sentiment. And I think anything that we can do to help efficiency with local government is something that we should promote and get behind. I'm going to address a little bit about the growth issue. I spend a lot of time looking at the demographics, the data for our community as well as communities across the state. For communities our size of around 10,000 people, it's a micropolitan community is what it's called, we are actually doing better than most around the state. We have about 1% annual growth over the past 20 years. That is not stellar. We need to be doing better. It doesn't feel like we're growing very much, but we are doing better than some, which is, so that's positive. But we need to be doing better, and we need people who see optimism and a way that this community can pull together and grow. There is so much going on here. What we can do to promote it is great, great stuff here, but we need to understand and recognize our great assets and then build off of those things. Regarding manufacturing jobs, Mahaska County has grown at a faster pace in manufacturing jobs since the Great Recession, since 2009, than almost every other county in the state. We have added significant number of manufacturing jobs. I've worked with a number of businesses across the community that are growing and expanding. No, we do not have a new 500 manufacturing job plant coming to town, but investments are being made, jobs are being hired, people are being hired for new jobs, and I think we have to recognize the great things that are happening in Oskaloosa and Mahaska County if we're going to move the community forward.
I'm going to put my 2 cents worth in, which is only 1 cent, is what we're asking for. Over 20 years ago, we had our city manager come to the library and said, I think I have found a solution on how to get the library raised and built without raising property taxes. And that's the 1 cent sales tax. County jumped in and said, yeah, we need a new law enforcement center. So we worked together and had that 1 cent sales tax pay for the library and the law enforcement center. When that time was up, the school system got it. Okay, we're getting to the point it is down again. We're up for 1 cent does not hurt anybody on sales tax. And I don't care what county you go to in Iowa, you're going to experience paying that sales tax. Why not let the sales tax fund what we really need in the community?
Thanks, Linda. I agree we need to do something to keep people and keep our young people around. I like the idea of the Environmental Learning Center because it shows off what we have and what we're proud of. As far as an asset, it seems like they built a bypass around us and went around Oskaloosa. 92 comes right through. We could slow them down as they come in and see that environmental center, see that we've been around a long time, and take the time to figure out why all those bones were left where they were and have volunteers show those off and be a lot less, or very much less inexpensive than if we hired high-profile staff. I don't know if everybody knows for sure where we're talking about the environmental center being. Dave, do you want to address that?
Well, I guess I didn't know.
Yeah, he's on.
I didn't know if everybody knows Caldwell Park is on the east side of town. It's just out of town, right next to Mahaska Vet Clinic, and the ground was actually donated to the county for the purpose of the Environmental Learning Center. It'll be a gateway coming into the community from the east, and like I said, it has a Freedom Rock right there too. Has a bike trail, so it's a great location where all those different groups can feed off of each other. And like Marge said, it's a way to show people, slow people down, get them into town. Being on that side of town, it also, I think, will benefit the community because you'll have the Lacey Sports Complex with all the kids and all the tournaments and everything out there. In between games, if people want to go see the Nature Center, go see the Mammoth Bones, they have to drive through town and they have to go past every restaurant. They have to go by the gas stations and everything, and so I think that'll also help with the economic impact for the community.
I have a question about existing infrastructure. Once the, if the ballot does pass, and we do build a new early childhood development center and a new environmental learning center, what does both groups intend to do with existing infrastructure, as well as how do both groups tend to fund filling their new buildings?
Okay, as far as the environmental learning center, the building out at Russell Wildlife will stay in operation as the maintenance operations for the County Conservation Board. We've been working with the construction manager. I'm looking at the increase, and there will be a slight increase in cost for operations having the two buildings. It's roughly a little less than 5% of our annual budget. We're trying to work with different funding options, I'll say. Nothing set in stone, depends on local option sales tax and ballot language and things such as that. But regardless, we're going to try to store more of our equipment inside, and any of you people out here that farm or have equipment, you know, if you can store it inside, you're a lot better off. So there will still be some programs out at Russell Wildlife because, let's face it, if you're going to do a fossil program, you have to go where the fossil beds are. The Youth Outdoor Field Day with the shooting and the fishing in the ponds and everything will still be held out at Russell Wildlife area because that's where we have the ability to do all that stuff. But there will be a slight, like I said, 4 to 5% increase in costs, and we're working right now on how to cover those costs.
From the YMCA perspective, the existing facility now, we have had some interest from a couple parties, but if those do happen to fall through, the Wiseman Christmas tree, whatever that, they sold Christmas trees, I know that. And they have around $15,000, I believe, in that. And so if those opportunities do fall through, that $15,000 is being held back, and they will apply that to a structure assessment to determine what opportunities there are with that facility to make it attractive to other people or other industries that are interested in reusing it. So it's there to really analyze the facility and then work with interested parties on what it would take to take that to the next level and serve their needs.
Okay, and your name, please.
My name is Ross Nilsson. What about filling the new YMCA building with equipment, and how do you intend to fund that?
That's actually in the budget. That's in the I don't know if anybody probably haven't heard this. It's $24 million, so that's in that budget. I believe there's $600,000 approximately that we've added to the budget, and so everything you see there is included with filling that building with the equipment and needs that we'll need to serve the Mahaska County community.
I'm Jody Steinlogge, and first off, I'm going to make a statement, and then I have a question. I'm an immigrant, as some people have called with different social media. I moved here 14 years ago. I came as a freshman from Idaho. I gave up my mountains for the cornfields. And I fell in love with this town. I decided to stay in this town after I graduated from William Penn. I got a job in Moravia, but I stayed in Oskaloosa. And then when my husband and I got married, fell in love with an Iowa boy, so then I was really stuck in Oskaloosa. That I subbed for 6 years in the Oskaloosa school district because I wanted my family to stay in Oskaloosa. I got a job 2 years ago. My husband works at William Penn. For people to say that people who did not grow up here do not have a vested interest in this community, I'm sorry, it's crap, okay? I have probably more of a vested interest here because my husband and I joke I'm gonna buy my burial plots here. I don't plan on dying anytime soon. So, and I tell my husband I'm gonna live to be 115. I got a long time before that happens. My kids are gonna grow up here. And the thing is that everyone says this town was great. No one is saying right now with these people who have this argument, this town is great, okay? My husband wrote a letter to the editor, and that's actually how I got involved because I got lots of hate mail. We were just sitting back, kind of just voicing our opinion. Made me angry, okay? I have a vested interest because there are so many kids, so many young people in this town that don't want to stay in this town because there is nothing to offer. People talk about the poverty in this town. If you do not keep families like my family here, in 30 years, when the older generation is gone, all that is going to be left is poverty. If people want to make Oskaloosa great, we need, okay, I get it. It was great or whatever. Times change. Okay, we have to change. You have to learn from history. You cannot stay stagnant. You have to be willing to change. I'm not saying, okay, leave the bandstand. That is our favorite activity as a family that we come up. My major was history. Americana, okay? I am proud to be an American. I am proud that I get to come and I get to listen to the music at the bandstand. I get that. But there has to be change. And with that change, if this doesn't go through with the rec center, Mr. Willett, which, by the way, we miss you guys. Just thought I'd throw that. What is going to happen to the Y? 3.5 years ago, I was diagnosed with a medical thing. They told me I would never walk again. The reason why I'm here is because I got up at 5 a.m. and I went and swam every single morning. Okay? If this doesn't go through, what is going to happen to the people that use that for health? What is going to happen to, I'm thinking this summer I want to go hang out with the older ladies in water aerobics. What is going to happen to the Y if this doesn't pass for those people who do utilize it and those people who can take advantage of something new that would come and become members to the Y?
Honestly, there's a relatively good chance that the Y doesn't exist if this doesn't pass. With what it has to offer and the inefficiencies involved with the existing layout, having really three different facilities, four if you count the elementary for childcare, it's going to be very difficult to sustain that. To sustain that due to the inefficiencies and costs associated with that. That's the answer to your question. And Dave, I would like to just make one brief comment to the gentleman that mentioned the Olwine Rec Center as well. We have not just curated this plan with our own infinite wisdom, because we have no idea going into what that was. We have benchmarked several other rec centers, whether they have a Y on front of them or not, and really analyzed, of which have built new facilities, by the way. And we saw the same thing in those the two facilities that we picked. And the reason why we picked them is demographically, they matched Oskaloosa and Mahaska County demographically almost to the T. So we grabbed onto those. They've built new facilities within the last 10 to 12 years. And we analyzed their memberships before, and we analyzed their memberships after. We went through their pro forma, which is their financials, with a fine-tooth comb to truly understand and make sure that we were doing the right thing. And all of those two facilities supported what we thought was going to be the case, and what gave us the confidence to move forward to where we're at today.
My name's Neil Brown. Hadn't planned on coming this morning really to ask questions about the rec center. You brought up some things, Mr. Willett, that concerned me a little bit. You talked about how good it's gonna be for the parents that have kids in the elementary that can take their kids back and forth, and about the Oskaloosa High School swimming program. Being from the rural part of the county, that's not gonna benefit me a whole lot. I kinda question why you would have the ability to stick your hand in my pocket to pay for that, why private industry is not paying for this rather than the taxpayers. My concern, being from the rural part of the county, is the roads in this county. Amen. And I understand that right now, through state formulas, we're spending as much on the roads in this county as we're allowed to by law. And we had a perfect opportunity to take this sales tax money and improve the roads in this county. And for some reason, the supervisors chose not to do that. So I'm not here to fight your project. I think you've got a good project, probably need some changes in it. We need to find a way to fund it privately, and we need to use our taxpayers for tax dollars for something that's gonna benefit everybody in the county.
I don't think anybody in the room or this facility or in the entire county is going to argue that good roads aren't important to everybody here. We've looked at that. We support roads. I mean, we think that it's a key component of our success as a county. There's other infrastructure or other taxes that have been put in place. I'm not going to speak for the county supervisors. I don't know. But we have the gas tax that's bringing additional revenue in that is designated 100% to the roads, and that is great. So everything we're talking about here, the entire ballot language is really new money. So we have, I think the gas tax is around, it's over $500,000, isn't it? Around $700,000 that'll bring in, that's designated directly to roads. As well as the proposal on the ballot now, I think that's $350 a year as well. So that's $1 million more. And I know I'm just talking about county, but it's over the 20 years, it's $5 million for the city as well, roads. So I know roads are important. And like I say, I don't want to argue about roads either, because they're extremely important to this community in the county as a whole. But with the existing taxes, with the gas tax and things of that nature, an additional $1 million a year from a county perspective will go towards the roads out there. And you know, at that point, we all have to agree as a team. Everybody in this room has to agree as a team that we all have decisions to make, and we could put them all towards roads. But at that point, what do we gain as a community? You know, we have to split this up and understand that there's key components that we need to meet as a community to meet our existing county needs as a whole, as well as continue to attract people here. If we have the best roads in the world, which I hope we can get, I don't want them to lead to Pella and Des Moines. I want them to lead to Oskaloosa and provide something here that people want to drive to. So that's my response to that.
My name is Vicki Wright, and I have lived across the street from the Y for a little over 40 years. I will have to say that when we moved here, there was a preconception that the Y was some kind of country club. What you have to realize is the Y is a nonprofit. The membership fees that they actually collect are collected to provide monies to run it. It's no different than the auditorium where you get monies from donors. The auditorium is also nonprofit. To have people think that the YMCA is a country club is unfair. Anyone in this room can go to the Y and go in and pay whatever kind of money it takes to swim without being a member.
Oh, right. My name's Jill Veldhuizen. I was born, raised, and I'll die here in Oskaloosa, Mahaska County. I just have a question on this rec center. I've just heard rumblings, and I just want it clarified. If this goes through, is Edmondson Swimming Pool, which a lot of money was put into a few years ago, that I was on one of the initial planning of that, is that going to be closed then?
Speculation on the Edmondson Pool is absolutely that. It's just merely speculation. The renewal of the penny and the projects it's going to fund has nothing to do with decisions made at Edmondson Pool. And everybody has passion about Edmondson Pool, and I get that. But what I would encourage people to do is, A, that decision won't be made for years, and B, that is something that the city council and those individuals will handle at that time, and that's about it for me on that.
In the planning out there in the new area.
The question was, is there a new outdoor pool as part of the plan that you have up there on the board?
It can be if you got enough money. No. As of right now, though, an outdoor pool out there is not part of the plan.
My name is Jay Gild. I live here in Oskaloosa. I just have one question. Actually, I guess it's one for each group. We've heard the long-term plans and what you want to do. I'd kind of like to hear the next 12 months, what you need, what you're trying to do, what you have on your docket for action plans, so that those that might want to contribute or have a voice in that can be there and take part.
Okay, as far as the Conservation Board, everything will depend on the local option sales tax, whether it passes or not, as far as our timeline goes. The $3 million price tag, and I want to state, you know, like they have in their budget for equipment, this $3 million price tag is just for the building and the infrastructure, and we'll still be looking for grants and donations to build the displays to fill the building. That's something we've been working on now, and quite frankly, had been kind of put on the back burner until we were sure we were making progress for the actual building. So the next 12 months, that's basically what we're going to be working on. If local option sales tax passes, then we'll be moving forward to try to break ground. The Conservation Board has a meeting the first Thursday of every month at 7:30 out at Russell Wildlife. If people are interested to come out and listen, it's a public meeting just like anything else. Also, the Friends of Mahaska County Conservation is a 501c3 nonprofit group that's been trying to work with us and other entities promoting conservation education in the county. Their meetings are at 6:30, the third, Monday of every month out at Russell Wildlife, and people are more than welcome to come to that and see what's going on and how they can try to help with the project, whether it's contributing time, money, input, you know, we're open to all of that.
Believe me, there's no organization in this community that wouldn't take funds with anybody willing to give to it.
I think on the branding side, really what we want people to do is to get excited about this brand. And a couple ways you can do that is by volunteering or letting us know that you're interested in volunteering in regards to the effort. We have a website, brilliantoskaloosa.org. And on that website is a submission form that you can fill out to let us know that you're interested in volunteering when those opportunities arrive, as well as go out and purchase some branding attire, like what you see people wearing around. Right now at Mahaska Drug, there's a 30% off sale until March 31st, so take advantage of that. But then as well, a couple things that are going to be happening in the next, well, I guess this summer anyway. You've heard about the Alley Project, so excitement there. If you have ideas or can lend a hand, whether it be with a tool or in another fashion, let the people, the Alley Cats behind that, know that you're interested. As well as one of the things that we're going to try to do is do movies in the park in the summer, where we get a blow-up screen and project movies onto the screen. So a couple of things to look forward to there. So yeah, thanks.
In the upcoming months, from the recreation perspective, we're our number one goal is to educate everybody and answer all the questions that you have, because it's a huge project. And I agree with everybody in here talking about how much money we're looking at spending on something like this. So we need input from the community to understand it. So we're going to continue to hold educational sessions with small groups. We'll try to do everything we can to publish when those are. Again, this isn't a secret. What also isn't a secret is One Mahaska. This is not a smoke and mirrors midnight meeting group. This is a group of individuals that all agree as a whole that the Environmental Learning Center, Rhodes, and the Rec and Education Center are the three main components that we hear people, obviously, we're all passionate about it. There's a lot of people here. Join us. I mean, we have meetings. You can come and talk. And that is not somebody trying to figure out how to slide this through. That is a group of individuals that are concerned about what people want so that we can get it right. So talk to me about it. We'll let you know. We'll get you on email groups, things of that nature, so that we continue to get as many people as we can, because with more people comes different perspectives and ultimately a better plan.
My name's Deb Draper. I was mislocated to Ohio in 72 as a youth. I moved back in 1990 to Oskaloosa. I've been here since then. My daughter graduated in 2002, and she was on the Y swim team all the way through grade school, high school. When she was in high school, she had to drive, and everybody had to drive to Ottumwa every day for their practices and join the Ottumwa team to swim for high school. I now have a son that's in high school. He's also a swimmer. He started on the Y team. He's now in the high school. It's a good thing that they have a facility here that they can swim in, but it's not big enough. They've got 3-4 kids in a lane swimming. They have to work around everybody else's schedules to even get any practice times. And the youth of our town and the surrounding communities, we live out in the country. We need this facility for them. What's going to keep them here? Pretty soon it's going to be all of us, just us old people, and there's not going to be any youth left because they're all going to move away. I feel that we need to support this to keep our youth here, to bring other people into the community. People come in to look for jobs and stuff, and they look, what else is here for us? And if there isn't stuff here for them, they're not going to stay here. Also, are we going to get a chance to vote on the rebranding like we're going to get to vote on all of this other stuff? Because there's a whole lot of money that's going to be put into this rebranding, and if the community's not really for it, then that could be better used in the for these other facilities that apparently people are interested in, like the Rec Center and the Environmental Learning Center. Thank you.
Appreciate the overall comments. I think looking positively for the future is definitely something we need to do. Regarding voting, regarding the branding effort, the big dollars that would be spent on it would be from local government, and so that's from our committee that we're working on is a lot of ideas and proposals. But when it really gets down to spending money, that's up to city council or other local government. So I guess that's my answer. There's other private money that's in, but the big infrastructure things and things like that would be local government.
Okay, that, you may remember when I had my opening comments, I said we were going to run until 10 o'clock, and it's 10 o'clock. So that wraps it up for what we have today. As I mentioned earlier, if you want to strike up a conversation with the folks that are up here, none of them are being paid by the hour. And so, you know, talk to them. Once again, we want to thank Smoky Row for allowing this event in their fine establishment, Midwest One Bank for providing delicious coffee to anyone who asks, featuring Steve Hicks, which the entire time there was not a single complaint about the way you poured the coffee. Man's flawless. We also thank Oski News, the Oskaloosa Herald, The Sun, CRI, KBOE Radio, and thank you to the viewing audience, that this is something that we need to have as much understanding as we can within the community, keep that dialogue going. And finally, thank you to everyone here at Smoky Row. As mayor of Oskaloosa, it does my heart a lot of good to see so many people interested in the activities of the community. Hopefully, you've been provided with good information, an understanding of the passionate people that are working for the betterment of the community. And then again, to mention Aaron Riggs and Andrew Jensen, Mark Willett, Linda Fox, and Dave Sedevec, we thank you very much for your involvement here as well. It's a hot seat to be in. And with that, I hope you have a good day. 60 degrees is nothing to sneeze at. Looks like we got a little of that coming. Thank you. Thank you very much.